Section 7.1 and 7.2 I've grouped together because the ideas are very similar. We'll see, I may have to break the video up into two parts, though, to keep it a little shorter. So we're going to talk about trees and spanning trees. This is really talking about building on the last couple of chapters, another way to connect a graph in a minimal sort of way. And here we're going to connect the graph to create a network of edges so that we get hit every vertex, but we don't want a circuit. An example of this would be maybe if we want to connect all the computers in a building to the company's main terminal. So the main terminal is here, and we're going to connect out, but I could connect through another computer, and maybe this one connects to a couple of computers, but I don't want to put in a circuit. I don't want to go back to this one because that's redundant. I can send communication back and forth across these lines, so this circuit becomes a redundant edge in our system. So we want to hit every vertex, and in this case these are the computers. Each vertex is a computer in a minimal sort of way so that we don't have to connect them too many times. In general, we're going to call something a network if it's a connected graph. And we might have weights in a network, or we might not. We could deal with either. So a network does not have to be something that does not have circuits. It can actually have circuits in it, and we're going to look for something, a part of it, a portion of the network that does not have circuits is called a tree. So this is a network with no circuits, or we could consider it a portion of a network without the circuits. So we're going to eliminate those redundant edges to get a tree. Now, in particular of importance in most of these applications is that we want to actually hit every one of the vertices, every computer in that computer connection problem. This is a spanning tree. A spanning tree connects every vertex of a network but has no circuits. So notice the difference between a tree and a spanning tree. A tree might connect only a portion of the network, could only connect a couple of vertices. A spanning tree has to connect all of the vertices, but neither one of them can contain circuits. If we have a weighted graph, we can talk about a minimum spanning tree. I'll just put ST for short. And so this is the least weight of all possible spanning trees. And so this is very similar to the previous chapters, where we're going to look at all possible spanning trees and we're going to find the one of minimum weight to solve our real life problem. Think about this in terms of our computer main terminal connecting out to these other computers, like we had before. Now, we want a minimum spanning tree of this network. We want to connect every computer in the building. The weights in this system might be perhaps cable length. Maybe we want to reduce the cable length between computers because of the issues that creates. Maybe it's cost. Maybe it costs more to connect the terminal to the computer directly above because we have some sort of interference right there. Really big floor joist or something, we just can't get around easily. So maybe we want to go out instead and bump up to the next floor over here, for example. Another example is that we might not want to bump through to the main floor multiple times. We might want to just go once and go across that floor, but that depends. So those are all things that we can consider in our weighted network. A minimum spanning tree will connect all the computers in the cheapest way possible, given all the connections in the network that are actually available. So I might not be able to connect directly this computer with a computer over here. Just not possible to get from one to the other, for example. Or maybe it's just not practical. I want to use the edges that are actually in the network already that we determined are our possibilities to add. Now we can look for trees in any graph. Any graph could be a tree. It doesn't need to be a portion of another graph. They just need to include edges in such a way that no circuits are created. And there's a couple other properties that go along with that. The first is that if I look at any two vertices in the graph, in a tree, there is one and only one path between those vertices. And the reason for that is because if there were more than one path, then I would actually have a circuit. If I could go from X to Y, if I could go this way, and I could also go this way, then I have a circuit. So that's not what I want in a tree. One and only one path between each one. The second thing is, every edge in a tree is a bridge. And in fact, this goes both ways. If I find a graph in which every edge is a bridge, then it's a tree. I know that it's a tree. If I find a graph in which for any two vertices, there's one and only one path between them, then it is a tree. So these are kind of checks as well as properties. The third thing is, among all the possible networks, among all the possible graphs on n vertices, and these are connected, so a network must be connected. Among all connected graphs on n vertices, a tree has the fewest edges. If I have n vertices and I'm connecting all of them, my tree will have n minus 1 edges, exactly. So let's suppose we have a tree with 5 vertices in it. How many edges are there? So we just said if there were n vertices, there's n minus 1 edges. So we must have 5 minus 1, or 4 edges total. So think about it this way. How do I connect these 5 dots? Well, I could connect them all out of one vertex, and I have 4 edges. I could connect them in more of a smooth path, but I still only have 4. So no matter which way I make a tree among these 5 vertices, I have 4 edges if it's a tree. And how many bridges does it have? Well, we stated in the properties that every edge was a bridge, so there must be 4. Take a look at either of these examples. If I take away this edge right here, I've disconnected the graph. It's a bridge. That's true for every single one of these edges here, is that if I take it away, it disconnects the graph, and so every one of them is a bridge. Now let's look at the complete graph on 4 vertices. So here we have A, B, C, D, and the complete graph includes all possible edges without having multiple edges or loops. And we want to come up with at least 4 different trees of K4. Okay, so I could just take the path A, B, C, D. That's a tree. Just like I saw in the last example I wrote up, I could just radiate out of B, A, and go A to B, A to C, and A to D. I can't really label these like paths or anything. I really have to have the graphical interpretation. I could tell you what edges to include, and that tells you what the graph is, what the tree is. I could also go from A to C to B to D, maybe. Here's something else I want to point out. If I just include the edge A to D and A to C, this is also a tree. It is a graph that doesn't have any circuits. Just because it doesn't cover the whole thing, well, that makes it not a spanning tree of K4, but it's still a tree of K4, so that's important. So here's my first one, my second one, my third one, and my fourth tree. And there's lots more. I could take any one edge, any two edges, etc. And I have lots of options here. So I think we're going to stop this portion of the video here and pick up the second part to get the spanning tree discussion. And that starts in 7.1 and continues in 7.2.